afternoon, everybody. This is Anthony from Amped Airsoft. I got my bow buddy
Matt,
and this is Asked Amp episode 36.
Yeah.
All right, 36. It's a question and answer show where we answer the stuff that you write down below in the doobly doo or on Facebook where we post this, and we try to be honest. It's pretty simple. Yeah, let's do it. Let's just
dive in.
Reach up in here and grab one. All right. Tactical tall person.
That's one of the two tallest buddies, I think.
Is it?
I think so.
I don't know. I don't exactly know when Anthony said this, but you said it was possible to flip your regulator to make it fit inside into a flat pack easier. I was wondering how to do this. I'm getting tired of running around with my flat pack flopping around when I run. Just so you know, I have an amped SLP regulator. Saggy bag syndrome.
Mm-hmm. Saggy map syndrome.
Okay, so this is... Okay, this is what you do. It's got a double-threaded piece that connects it to the UFA. You literally just kind of hold the wrench, hold the threading with a wrench in the UFA, and then you just go... And then that's it.
It's pretty simple.
It's really all you got to do, man.
If you're worried about breaking anything, just get some plumber's tape, and I think you'll need just one crescent wrench, correct?
Yeah, that's it.
And then you can, if you really want to, I would recommend only spin the threading out of one thing, probably the UFA. Make sure your tank is off.
No, not
or make sure
pressure.
The UFA is off, no pressure or anything.
No pressure.
And then just back it out and put it where you want. It's really not that hard. Biggs does it all the time. Yeah.
It's double-sided. One of my buddies came into the shop and he was like, I was like, you could just run the regulator upside down, when he was talking about his, and he was like, how do you do that? And I was like, you just turn it. And he's like, well, I don't know if I could do that. I don't want to do it and mess it up. And I was like, okay. So I was like, follow me. So I took him downstairs and I walked him up to Biggs. And I was like, Biggs, could you show him how to flip his regulator upside down so he can fit it in his backpack easier? And he goes, and that was it. It's really that simple. It's really that it.
It is.
It's not a big deal.
Smurfkilla369. Just crossing over from real steel, and I'm trying to figure out Airsoft. I came across the Pleb to Pro series. Now I'm making my way through all of our Ask Amp videos. That's
interesting. Good job, man.
Have fun with that. I'm not done.
Sandwich.
I'm not done yet, so sorry if my questions have already been answered before. What are your thoughts on Airsoft as a spectator sport? Live delayed, televised, online, speedball, milsim, both, blah, blah, blah. If it ever happened, who would you want the two commentators to be? My pick would be Anthony and Brian Stan, Marine UFC fighter and commentator.
That dude sounds way more qualified than me. Fuck.
Lastly, have you seen the Overwatch phone app? It's an in-game GPS overview map of the UAV. Yes.
Yeah, it uses Google Earth.
Yeah, I've seen
satellite view, and then you can like track your bros around as you
never
like,
used it, but it does look cool.
I've seen it. I've never tried it though. It looks interesting. Maybe we could dick off with it. I don't know.
We should get it. We'll ask Kirk to get one.
You have to pay for it, probably.
Probably. Commentators or spectator sport. It's interesting. It's hard to visualize how people would gain like fun from watching it because it's such a experience driven.
Let's look at it like this. I used to have a buddy of mine who was a professional paintball player, and paintball used to be, I don't know if it still really is on like ESPN and stuff like that, but it used to be a spectator sport. Even woods ball, they used to have cameras up in trees, and then dudes would have paintball matches, and then they would have commentators live commentating it just like you would at a football game or a basketball game or whatever. So it's already been done. The framework's already there, and it would just be transferring from paintball over to BB Wars. Now the big thing about speedball is that usually it's in a very contained area, which would be a lot more conducive to
recording
and stuff like that. And then Milsim would have a problem where usually, like, they take up a lot, like, those types of games usually are a lot more maneuver and fire and maneuver type stuff. So, like, they take up a lot more space, which would be hard to record.
Usually, and then, of course, one person don't get to see the entire picture of a Milsim game because there's so many elements going on.
So, like, that would be difficult, though they used to do woods ball tournaments, so it's not impossible. Now, here is my problem with making it into a spectator sport. And this has to come, this comes from a couple of different things.
Yeah, I know where you're going.
My first problem is that if it's a spectator sport, that means manufacturers are going to want to have their products repped, mm-hmm. which means there's going to be sponsored players and sponsored teams. Now, Amped Airsoft, full disclosure, we do have some sponsored teams and a few sponsored players, and they are really great people, and we have, like me and Saffron and Matt here, have personally selected everyone who's mm-hmm. who's doing it.
Personally met all of
and
them.
And I've met all the ones that came before when I before yeah. I worked there. And so the reason that they still are is because of our graces. We've thought mm-hmm. that they were good people, and we decided to keep them. It's not necessarily that they rep our products. It's just that they promote a good image of BB Wars and the way that you're supposed to act. Like Tom, for example, mm-hmm. or Richie, or...
Mike, calling your hits.
Like
dudes who just represent what the game is all about.
Being friendly and yeah. nice, and you know, we'll give them free stuff so that they can hand free stuff out to local players.
Mm-hmm.
Now, so companies are going to want to get involved, and they're going to have sponsored teams and sponsored players that are mainly just there to rep their products. So that already breeds an aspect of adding a unhealthy amount of competition to something that's honor-based.
Mm-hmm.
Because BB Wars is an honor-based game. It's not like paintball. So that brings me to my next point, is that when people are starting to get sponsored and potentially paid
yeah.
by companies to represent them, there's going to be money involved in transactions, and then that's also going to be performance-driven. And then
yep.
performance-driven in an honor-based sport may lead to cheating. I'm not saying that it will,
yeah.
but it may lead to cheating, and then which would invalidate the entire thing. That's why paintball has referee systems and scoring systems and stuff. Mm-hmm. It was to curtail cheating.
Yep.
Airsoft doesn't have a projectile that marks. It doesn't leave a mark. So already it's at a disadvantage compared to paintball in a spectator sport arena, because at least then you could wind back film and definitively yeah. know for sure someone
gets hit. That's what I mean. Having a third party camera filming thing.
Like, I've cruised on YouTube, for example, of people watching other people's, and people commenting on other people's videos saying, oh, you definitely got hit here, oh, you definitely did it, and you can only see it from certain perspectives. You can't say that. You don't know if they got hit. And so, and because it doesn't leave marks, it doesn't yeah. leave verifiable proof that it that someone was hit, so it's just conjecture, and then people get in arguments, and they show video of people that they think are cheating,
yeah.
which I also do not agree with, by the way. That's a whole other thing. I don't agree with that either.
Yeah.
Because if someone's a bad person, you just let them get sorted out by the community. You don't need to be the personal savior of your community. You don't need to be calling other people out.
Yeah.
Because basically, it's just as dishonorable to call someone else's honor out as it is to be dishonorable.
It really
someone
is.
Who has high self-esteem and high self-respect will not call other people out. They will play their game and enjoy their game with their friends as they see fit.
Mm-hmm.
They do not need to ruin someone else's experience. But that's the problem with making it a spectator sport. Do I think it's impossible? No. Would I be interested in maybe watching it or commenting on it? Yeah, I could see that, as long as it was not, you know, something that was money-based. If
yeah.
it wasn't some, if it was something that was done purely just for fun and it didn't have, like, egos and corporate money and stuff on the line, yeah, I think it'd be interesting. I think it'd be hilarious.
Well, I know some people try to do it. One of Rich's guys from Team Fart, I don't know if he went through with it, but when they came to visit Pittsburgh, he wanted to live stream their game from his helmet cam.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah.
Things
yeah.
like that, I think, are really interesting.
That,
if you
want
to actually live stream, you know, like, your GoPro, if you have the proper
yeah.
setup.
Oh, yeah, if you have the proper setup to do that, that's interesting,
like,
as hell. I'd love
like,
to see that.
So
you can put it on Twitch or YouTube Gaming,
yeah.
which is, that's what that is. We figured,
yeah.
I figured that out yesterday. It's for video game streaming.
Okay.
So technically, Airsoft is a game. You could probably use YouTube Gaming to live stream footage of you playing.
So I think because...
it'd be interesting.
Because the usage of first-person cameras like GoPros and Contours and all the other cameras coming out now is so prevalent in Airsoft, I think that would kind of be the route you'd want to go. It would be like live streaming or recording and chopping together later, kind of like what our gameplay videos are.
Like, for example, like
yeah.
a good guy who does this is Robo Murray, because whenever he does his gameplay videos, all of it is pretty much from his first-person perspective.
Mm-hmm.
So when anything looks even remotely weird or sketch, he just tells you exactly what happened. Because
he tells you what he thinks or what he knows happened.
Exactly. You know? And so what happened, and he never calls anybody out. He never is mean or self-righteous or anything about it. He's so Canadian it hurts. He's so nice.
He really is.
And so, like, that's what I would like to see. If we were going to do something like that, it would have to be like that. Not
mm-hmm.
because paintball had a huge, like, a big, huge rise really quick because of all that corporate money and TV. Like, my friend, my personal friend, he was on TV. He was on ESPN.
Yep.
My buddy Casey, he was on ESPN. He was in like one of the top ranked teams in the country.
Yeah.
And like, you know, and he had money thrown at him for being a pro player who was very young at the time too. And like, and then that huge rise with all that corporate money did end up having a big, huge fallout, which was not good.
Yeah, the ceiling blew through really quickly.
There's a whole lot of subtle nuance to that question. But short answer, do I think it's interesting? Yeah, sure. Mm. Would I do it if someone asked me to? Yeah, sure. As long as it was friendly and not super high competition-based or anything like that, yeah, I would do it. Because it'd be interesting to just comment on it and watch it and be like, oh, dude, watch this. This dude's going to get aced. Oh, this dude doesn't know that dude's around the corner.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, no. Like, it would be fun. I'd enjoy it.
Commentators. I would love to have Josh Warren do it because his commentary would be hilarious.
His dry sense of humor is pretty epic. For people who have not experienced it, it's pretty fucking funny.
And like, then him and Joe Rogan, think about that one.
Joe Rogan. Though he's so animated, though.
Yeah, exactly.
He's like,
those. I feel like those two could play off each other. It'd be very interesting. It'd be like,
that and
it would
Joe
be
Rogan,
like the commentating of a UFC fight. Like when for Ronda Rousey knocks Rogan's, somebody out in 20 seconds.
For all of Joe Rogan's hilarious stoner humor that he has in his stand-up.
His stuff's pretty square.
When he commentates for UFC, he has such a strong technical knowledge. So like anything that you put him in, he gains a really strong technical knowledge of.
Exactly.
And he learns it in and out. So that way when he talks, he doesn't sound stupid, which is a big deal.
So he would learn airsoft in like a weekend.
Yeah,
and
he would just
know more than we do.
Yeah, he would just sit down and then just roll it. And it'd be hilarious because he'd be funny as fuck.
Yep.
But I'm flattered that you'd pick me. I'm pretty stupid, though.
your head would be in your hands the entire like,
what do you mean? No! Oh, my God!
Just constantly upset with everyone's performance.
That's not how you hold it!
Transition shoulders!
You should see me when I watch YouTube videos of other people playing. I'm like, change shoulders. Pip, 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 pip. And I'm like, I told you, should have changed shoulders.
Go for it.
All right, Connor Beattie. Betty, I'm sorry. Hey guys, I have a G&G standard combat machine and was thinking of buying the SR-47 challenge kit for it.
Cool.
I wanted to know if you guys could put it together for me. I've never taken it apart before and I need help getting some extra internals like buckings and inner barrels. He got butchered by the autocorrect monster.
Yeah, that's fine.
The inner barrow. and thanks for all the help on the videos. Keep it up. Hashtag.
That's what we're here for.
He spelled some wrong. No,
damn,
I'm sorry.
It.
Hashtag Steelers for life. Hashtag never go full retard. Hashtag shoe game strong. Here's the thing. G&G doesn't make an SR-47, so there's no guarantee that if you buy an SR-47 kit from, like, Evike or...
What kit did he say it was?
He didn't say which one it was. He made it seem like G&G. It's a G&G kit, but G&G doesn't make one. So here's the deal. The G&G internals of your combat machine are a standard V2.
Mm-hmm.
So if you bought a challenge kit from, say, like Evike or some other place, yeah, we could build it for you because that takes a standard V2 gearbox. Yeah. It has a really weird, goofy hop-up, so do not expect stellar performance, but it would be neat to have.
Yeah.
It will shoot okay, but, like, the weird, goofy hop-ups and those things are really hard to work with, and they're not...
We'd definitely be able to get your hop-up. What in there that we could upgrade, we'd be able to upgrade. So if you find the parts,
but yeah, it's just, but it takes
do as
all
much research
same.
As you can on what.
So basically,
fits.
you would just gut it,
yeah,
and then put the main portion of your internals from your combat machine into the kit.
Yeah,
the kit should come with everything, but probably an outer barrel. And if it does come with an outer barrel, it'll come with the outer barrel, the SR-47 style URX original URX rail. The body obviously will take AK mags and have the AK toggle and the M4 mag release. It's pretty cool. Our tech Johnson had one for a while. It was pretty neat.
I love SR-47s.
It's such a neat, here's the thing though. There are more airsoft SR-47s than there ever were real firearms of that ever in existence.
Mm-hmm.
It's like the Stoner 63.
Yep.
The Stoner 63A, the GMP one. There are more airsoft of those guns than there ever were real firearms of that gun.
I got Smurf Killa 369. Wasn't the first one I just had? No,
I don't know.
This is the most informative airsoft YouTube channel.
Thanks, bro.
We try.
I just try not to suck at life. That's basically what I do.
And we translate it onto YouTubes. I'm just getting started with airsoft, and I want to get a G&G GC 146 in an Inferno. My question is, will it work? I don't care if the electric blowback works. If it does, cool, but not important. I just really like the configuration. Comes in tans, all metal. Thank you. Keep up the good work. Yeah, you wouldn't have any problems with that.
Your blowback wouldn't work. It would just kind of be useless just sitting there.
Yeah.
You'd probably take it off, to be honest with you, and just have your dust cover open and close without a fake bolt.
Yeah, that's
about
all you'd
have
to worry about.
That would be your easiest thing to do. And to be honest with you, Electric blowback kits, though they seem really cool, typically are just one more thing that eventually breaks and you never get fixed again anyways.
I never liked the electric ones because they it took so much more extra power to cycle it. It would just drain your battery, and your gun always seemed to function so much slower.
Would it fit in there? Yeah. Would that function? Probably no.
Literally all those are is a standard V2 with a little, like, spring rod cylinder up on top of the
gearbox. It just catches the air as it cycles and makes it kind of flop around. Yeah. It's whatever. But yeah, the Inferno would fit in there.
Yeah, you'll be fine.
Yeah, I'm fine. No big deal. So with the jack, so with the...
every dropping.
Yeah, like the SMP.
Mm-hmm.
All that stuff would fit in there. Belgian Waffle Airsoft. Yo, Amped, I got a Crytac Trident PDW because I play a lot of CQB. Job, bro. I just used it in a outside skirmish yesterday and was getting really good range with this little thing, but the grouping could be better. So I'm looking for a good inner barrel, but the length is kind of the problem. 155mm is hard to find. Do you think cutting a bigger tight bore inner barrel down to size is a good thing to do? Hashtag Belgians make the best weapons. Hashtag Belgian fries. Hashtag Belgian beer. Hashtag Belgian chocolate. I could agree with a few of those.
I love Belgian things.
I could agree with a few of those things, but I'm going to be real honest with you. The FS2000 kind of sucks. I'm sorry. The real FS2000, I've shot one a bunch of times. The trigger sucks. They're not very great. They're needlessly complicated, and they field strip weird. And the fact that they don't eject spent casings, which can cause jams, is also stupid. Sorry. FS2000, not that great. Though FN, you know, the SCAR... all about the SCAR, especially the heavy. Now, that is pretty good.
SCAR life.
So the Trident PDW, here's the thing. People always mistake short barrel for no range. The length of your barrel has nothing to do with the range that your BB gun can shoot. Your range is affected by how well and how well constructed the parts for your hop-up and barrel are, how good the air seal is between all of those parts and your gearbox or HPA setup.
Compression.
So that's your compression. That's basically what that is.
Mm-hmm.
And then also the output velocity of the weapon and the air volume that it produces versus the weight of your projectile. So you can take a short-barreled gun and shoot excessive ranges. At the Texas Irene, the one that was last year, I had a 185mm barrel on my Polar Stare, and I had a little tiny little PDW, like Amoeba.
Yeah, your Amoeba.
The game Amoeba Force. Oh man, I loved it in that though. It was so I just got annoyed with it because it didn't fit me very well. I was too big for it.
Yeah, it sounded funny.
It sounded funny.
It shot dirty.
I sniped a dude off of a roof from about 110 yards out. I was granted.
No, you shot the guy over the building.
Yeah. So he was. It was about 110 yards out, and we were 3 stories up. We were on the roof.
Yeah, three
and then
stories.
I shot over a 1-story building and hit him. And now that was only with a 185 barrel. So only.
Threes.
Threes, yeah, with threes. So that was only 30 millimeters longer than what you're doing.
Mm.
Eric also has the same gun, but he built it with a 1911.
Eric's is dirty.
Little barrel. Yeah. It actually shot, because it was a PDI barrel, it shot better than mine. We can get you short barrels like that, but the problem is that they're hard to find and manufacturers don't make them very often, mainly because people still have this stigma where they think long guns equal more range.
Well, the other thing is, like, manufacturers, they can sell longer barrels because the longer it gets, the more it costs.
Yep.
So technically, short barrels would be cheaper.
Yep.
And that kind of falls to the wayside because everybody pushes the idea that length, you know, the American way,
bigger is better.
Not always.
So what I would suggest, if you're looking for tighter groupings, so, like, range is not your issue, obviously, because you're shooting well, because that just proves my point right there, that your range isn't the issue. Now, where your longer barrels tend to help is your groupings. Longer barrels tend to pull your groupings together, basically because what's happening is it's keeping the BB in the barrel and keeping it from being affected by wind and outside forces and helping it accelerate for a longer period down the barrel in the intended direction of firing. So typically that pulls your groupings together a little bit. Not substantially, but it will do it a little bit. So, like, a carbine will shoot... So, like, let's say you have a 10-inch barrel and it shoots a grouping about like this at a given range.
Mm-hmm.
A carbine, so a 14.5-inch barrel versus a 10-inch barrel, will probably bring it into about like here.
Yep.
It's not substantial. It's not like you won't ever hit what you're shooting at.
It'll be noticeable, but it won't be...
It won't be life or death, and it won't be, like groundbreaking.
Yeah. The other thing you can do, which this might not be an option because you said you're playing a CQB field, and a lot of times they limit ammo weight. you could look at getting heavier rounds, and those that does that helps a lot too. Like going from a 2.5 to like a 3.6, you'll notice a lot of difference with like downrange consistency.
Now your gun might suffer range performances based on how it's built, because some guns just aren't built to output enough air volume to move a heavy BB.
Yeah, because you have such a short barrel, you're just going to sit down one of these days and do some
testing. Just tinker with it. Get a bunch of guys together who have longer guns and shoot different weight BBs. Be like, hey, can I borrow some 3.2s? Can I borrow some 2.5s? Go out there and walk out like 200 something feet, 300 feet, and then just shoot at each other and see how well it shoots.
With goggles on.
Or lay out targets and measure it out.
Yeah.
And then you'd be surprised exactly. Like, that's the first thing I tell people. They're like, I want better range and accuracy. If they come into the walk-in store, the first thing I tell them is to get better BBs.
Yeah.
I'm like, what brand
BBs? What are you using? Crossman?
What weight BBs do you use? I'll use 2s. I'm like, step up to 2.5s at least.
Yeah, 2.8s.
Try 2.8s. Try 3.2s. Like, keep going up. Because you'd be surprised. Like, some guns that shoot 400 FPS, like, that's over-voluming the barrel for most weight BBs, and most people are only shooting like 2s or 2.5s out of it, and they're like, my gun shoots like crap. I'm like, use heavier BBs.
Mm-hmm.
Use 3s in your 400 FPS gun.
You'll technically be
chronoing hot if you have a 1.5 joule limit, but you'd be surprised how much better it shoots. Like, just do that.
Yeah.
Hope I answered your question, kinda. Sorry. It got a little off topic, but...
Connor Mick hashtag Gingerbeard Airsoft. What's a good way to sell or get rid of old gear? I have a bunch of gear and guns, and I want to get rid of them to start some new projects. Should I sell them at my field, or should I do something, I'm assuming something else? What tactics should I use as a salesman in between games? Oh, and first, hashtag Robbie's grassy knees. And then the whole kebab thing. How do you cream fill a banana? How do I get cries? Hashtag Ginger
Their
Airsoft.
Website.
Yeah, online.
Online. And here's the thing, like, I can only teach you guys how to internet so well. At some point it becomes
before
time,
you have to fly the coop and
before,
learn yourself.
Before the baby, I can only feed the baby birds so much before the baby birds have to learn how to fly on their own.
Yep.
Here's my thing, if you're going to sell stuff at your field, that would be an easy place to go first, because then you can have people have direct exchanges.
That's one of the number one things, especially with used gear, is people want to know what they're getting.
And they
can
see it
and hold it in hand. That's usually the final push for a sale. Like when we do our mobile vend at events,
a lot of dudes who go there, they'll look at an HSGI belt online for like 3 years, and they'll be like, I don't know if I want to buy it. It's expensive.
One.
And then they see it and they're like, this is really nice. I need it. And then they buy it. Like, that's why we bring expensive stuff to vends, because that impulse control is very low.
Yeah, but dudes, they get some good deals on some good stuff.
We do some smoking deals on stuff for people who really want it. But, like, I would go on, like, Airsoft classified sections on Facebook, read all their rules, read all the rules. For the love of God, people who do Facebook groups, read all of the fucking rules.
And up on the top right... There is a search thing.
Read a search thing. Search for what you're looking for in the search thing.
It's probably already talked about somewhere.
Yeah, do a search in the little search bar in Facebook.
Mm-hmm.
Also, like I said, read all the rules. Read the files sections, because a lot of times, like, people put things in Word documents that you can download onto your computer and like find and have answers. Like when people ask us what BBs and what barrels and stuff, I'm like, if you go to Polar Star's owner group, John Hill is a super great dude. Me and him have talked a little bit on Facebook. He's a super nice dude. He has a huge files section that has all that shit laid out for you. You literally do not have to ask that question. Like, you don't have to
anymore.
Ask it anymore. It's in there. Like, I'm telling you where to get
it. We're going to get 8 questions of that now.
I know. People are just going to troll me now, but it's okay. I'm all right with it. But, like, yeah, I can't really tell you how to sell stuff, because, in all honesty, when I sell stuff, I go about it in a completely different way than some people. Like, a guy like Zach Bruce or Robbie, who like to move gear really quickly, or, like, Stu.
They flip a lot of gear quick.
They flip a lot of gear quick. So what happens is they build a reputation online as being a good salesman and not lying to people. And their rep is what helps them sell stuff quickly.
Yep.
And then they're really good at getting things shipped in a timely manner, so people don't think they're getting scammed, and they don't lie to people. So a lot of, like, online sales are based on your reputation. I know a few guys who had problems selling some stuff. So then, like, you know, they'd be generally if someone's looking for something to sell
vouchers,
and they have,
yeah.
and they don't have it, they're, no one's biting. They're like, can someone vouch for me? And then, like, guys will vouch on, like, say Zach Bruce, he'll get like 40 vouches because, like, the dude is really good with, like, taking care of people when they buy stuff from him.
Yeah.
and like Robbie does the same stuff. Like a lot of guys do that. Me personally, I like to either hand my stuff off to guys like that so that I don't have to deal with people talking to me, and I just set a minimum price that I'm willing to accept, and then they just deal with all the hassle for me, and I'll let them cut a piece of the profit.
Yep.
Or I'll build like a an eBay listing, and then that'll just be for, I'll put a buy now price and I'll put a minimum reserve on it, and then like that's it, that's what it sells for.
I prefer to do everything in person, like,
and I like
flea
to do stuff in person
and stuff like
face
that
to face, because I really like to see people look at my stuff and realize that I'm not screwing with them.
It's so much easier just to talk to someone face to face too, instead of like
having
to send them like, if you can just show them a piece of gear or a gun, that's it. Like, you can't hide that.
Mm-hmm. But so, look, it's like new. Do you want to put your stuff in it? Do you want to put the mag in your gun? Do you
want to
put a battery in the
like
gun and shoot it and see what it's like?
You want to see if your pack fits on it? Like, you can just go for it. So
yeah, I'm real easy like that when I want to sell stuff. I'll be like, hey, do you want to buy this from me?
Everyone's
like, oh, okay.
We literally have no date or definitive plans for this,
but
I know the shop is planning.
We're planning on
planning to do like a flea market by in the store. The store.
People can come in and buy, sell, and trade in the store with both the employees and with
just anybody else.
Anybody else
up
that's there. And so, like, if you're like looking for some Gucci stuff, like, a lot of us at the shop have a lot of really nice stuff. Like, I got, like, thousands upon thousands of gear, of dollars in gear.
Dollar gears.
Gears of dollars.
Pull a short one.
So, like, you know, I'd be willing to sell if it was the right person. I like to make sure that people are the right people to sell to, too.
That too.
I'm really picky about who I sell to. Like, if someone I know is an asshat or they're trying to rip me off so they can flip it, I'll just tell them to go fuck off and walk away.
True.
I'm a dick about it. True stud muffin. Hey, Amped, I was looking to buy an M27 IAR because the guys I roll with need a support man.
There you go.
And I don't want to lug around a saw or anything that large, since I'm already kind of like the pack mule. I carry extra water and BBs and snacks for longer games, including my own stuff in a larger backpack. Do you think the M27 would be good for field play, or should I look into another type of support gun? And yes, my field considers an M27 a support gun. Okay, so that's good.
I like
good.
Your field.
Thanks. The yoga pants game is strong.
their game
no,
was very strong.
Damn, them girls, man. That shit was strong.
Dude almost fell off when you saw the spider.
Dude, well, the best part was that amongst all of the chicks, there was one dude, and he climbed up there and doing the thing that, like, the exercise thing that all the chicks were doing, and when he saw this spider at the top, he yelped and almost fell, like, 30 feet to the ground. That's when me and him were like, because like we couldn't say anything because we were like on one side of the camera.
If you
could have seen it, you would have died.
I forget what moment it was at, but if you
we're
listen
both
to the
just
video
like,
right before we make the face, you'll hear like a
like
he's
the
dude
like
screams
ah!
in the background.
Like, he almost, like, we're just like, oh, he made it! Damn it! Because 30 feet is enough to kill you, but it's enough to make you miserable.
They had a mat. They're okay.
They were fine.
Yeah.
So is the M27 a good gun? The M27 is a pretty reasonable gun. Shoots pretty great, actually.
Yeah, I'd say do it. Get a nice barrel hop-up build, and you'd probably be pretty Gucci.
I'm like, I personally would go with something a little bit more, because the thing with the M27 is that in the real world, they don't get issue high-capacity magazines.
Yeah, standard.
And so they have to use standard mid-cap. So if you were to be a realistic IAR gunner, you would just have dozens of mid-caps, and you would just blaze with mid-caps constantly and full auto. So like if you were to do it as a real world equivalent, if I were to have something that would be more true to a support gun and is a real support gun actually, but is still usable like an M4, I would probably go with a Shrike.
Yeah.
I love Shrikes.
If you feel it allows that.
Because then you can use V2 upgrade kits and V2 upgrade parts and V2 upgrade hop ups and everything's nice and standard. And the box mag locks into an M4 magwell because it's an M4 lower receiver with an M4 selector switch.
Mm-hmm.
I personally prefer Shrikes, but is the M27 a bad gun? No, it's a great gun. It actually shoots really good stock. Only things I would suggest for it is a better hop-up bucking nub and barrel. And that's it.
Other than that, you're pretty much
other
good.
Than that, it'll just shoot well for a long time.
Yeah.
A bunch of my friends had them because they had, like, limited edition ones, black ones. They had, like, between them, they had, like, four of them at one point between, like, all my group of friends. And, like, they all shot really good. They all shot really good, actually. Not my thing, personally, because I think M27s are a little heavier than they need to be. But, I mean, good guns overall, though. Shoot fine.
Yeah, definitely.
All right, so we're doing it. 5-minute frenzy. Explosions. Go time. Anthony DePascal, last weekend I won the Vulcan Battle Machine Mod L in a raffle. The rifle is better than I thought it would be for Vulcan. The thing is, I want to get more range out of it. How can I do this without breaking the bank? Thanks from Connecticut. Hop-up barrel builds. So a hop-up chamber, hop-up rubber, nub, barrel. That's how you can get a lot out of it, actually. If your FPS is pretty low, you can also get a tight bore barrel that'll help kind of artificially add more FPS to your gun. People forget that's actually the original reason why tight bore barrels exist. It had nothing to do with accuracy. It had to do with upping your FPS of your gun without opening the gearbox. Mm-hmm. That's how tight bores used to be marketed. But, I mean, it's basically the Vulcan Battle Machine is an SRC polymer-bodied M4 from the company SRC. They've been around for a long time. They just aren't very popular here in America. But they take standard M4 parts, so just, yeah, you're fine with whatever you want. This is going to not end well because I'm over-answering that question. But Smurfkilla369, if I order a gun barrel, hop-up bucking, and banana from you guys, can you remove the orange tube? Not if we ship. We can't ship it like that. Nope. We can loosen it, but we can't take it off. Nope. It's got to stay permanently affixed. The Banana Man, what is the most ridiculous funny costume you've seen in your long years of Pew Pew Wars? Amped is loved. When I went to Revelations, there were dudes dressed up as Jesse and Walt from Breaking Bad, and they were selling blue meth at Revelations. That was pretty hilarious. Gerardo Estrada, those girls in the intro of the video totally looked dumb. Let's just say they charge for services. Hey, now that is not friendly, and you are assuming. They're college-age girls.
Come on.
Dom Real, a local guy. Hey guys, so I may be picking up a TMMP7 and I just picked up an A&K M60 for project guns. So in your opinion, Jack or regular fusion engine? P.S. Next time you're down at the shop, you're downtown, stop at my restaurant. Ask Kurt. He knows about it. Thanks, fellas. I should say which will be easier. I'm assuming the Jack will be for both. The Jack won't fit so well in the MP7 because the MP7's small.
Yeah, it still needs a lot of
fabrication. Still needs a lot of fabrication work. But the M60 will take both of them. The fusion engine has more efficiency and can get more performance out of it, but the Jack is just way easier to do. So it just depends on, like, what you're in the mood for.
Yeah, just look up Bingo stuff. I think he makes a kit. I'm not positive, though.
Too tall. That Starbucks refresher. Nilsson Beverage of Champions. Robbie's my love child.
Just for you, too tall.
Say it, Hathley. I prefer those lemonade sodas that I've been drinking lately. Those are good. Yep. Jordan Davis. I don't hate you, Matt. I love you and your majestic beard.
It's your SDS rack, bro.
I know. That's my rack, bro. Rack bros for life. I got a desert one now, too. Looking for patches.
I'm on the hunt for Paraclete. Let me know.
I made chocolate chip cookies to the battlegrounds, and they were gone in like 2 seconds. Would you want some? Well, if they were gone, how could I get some?
He'll make more.
The thing is like, I'm busy, man. You got to come to the shop. I'm not going. Mario Avila, Amp, two thumbs up for Matt for censored all that up. Do you guys heard anything about Odin Innovation Speedloader? Yes. I think it's called the M12, and will you carry them? I would love to carry them. Matt has a girlfriend. Still a trend. Matt could be a model. Anthony is too cool to operate. Man, I'm way too cool to do shit right now. I'm lazy as hell. Foxhound Airsoft. Anthony saying TM make me gasp.
At 1 a.m.
Hey, here's the thing, man. It's not that I hate TM. It's just I think that it's time for them to come out of the lazy sector and start doing some new stuff. That's what I'll say. That's why they're overrated in my book. Hayden Gerard, hey, they never said they had to be smart to join the Marines, lol, but that's the way we like it. Bring the suck for months at a time. Great vid like always, guys. Hashtag best job I've ever had. Hashtag Marines still the best. Hashtag suck it, Anthony. That's fine. Hashtag Marines really do draw dicks on everything. Yes, you guys do. Literally, like I said, we just convince you to do all this shit. We're like, it's way too hard for us. And then we just let you go do all of our stuff for us. Welcome to the E4 Mafia.
Oh,
Dylan Shren, instead of a VSR-10, get a Bar-10. It's going to be completely gutted anyways.
Oh, he's on to us already. Uh-oh.
Catch my BBs. Will you guys be making anything for the Jack, like how you made the purple nozzle for the fusion engine?
Not really anything we can make.
There's not a whole lot we
besides
can do.
Besides our standard IGL fits onto the Jack, that's
we're,
about the only
we're talking
part.
With Polar Star about stuff we could do for it or what their plans are so that we don't step on each other's toes. So we'll see. Something might come out, something might not. It just kind of depends on where all that stuff goes.
Yeah.
Ben Glazinski. Opinion on no bang bang. It's becoming pretty standard rule in Ohio unless you have your flash hider directly in their booty. Hashtag knife kill. I do not like bang bang kills because then it starts arguments. If you're in a game to play pew pews and get hit, then you might as well just take the hit and be a man about it.
Make it definitive. I mean, yeah, it happens occasionally when you have somebody dead to rights. That's fine.
Sometimes,
to call.
Like if I walk up behind somebody and I'll be like, "Hey, bro, you cool?" And they'll be like, "I'm cool." And
yeah,
then that'll be it.
That's fine.
That's fine.
Don't say bang bang. Oh, is that it? One
yeah,
more.
Yeah, I'll do two.
You had that one pulled.
I'll do two more just because like I really over-answered that one. Trayman14, I have a CSA Scorpion. Do you think I could fit a Polar Star Jack into it? I have seen people take the little tiny Scorpions, the AEPs like the Tokyo Marui ones, and put cut down fusion engines in them as well as
I've never seen those
jacks and stuff. It's very rare, and I've not seen a whole lot of proof that it's real. I've just seen like internet photos.
Yeah.
So do I think you could fit it into it?
Maybe,
but I'm not going to say for sure because I literally have no clue.
Again, check Bingo's website. If anybody's done it,
you can
to
at least,
any good amount,
he
it
doesn't
was probably
he doesn't typically do custom installs anymore just purely because he
well, I'm saying
is
like
focusing
if he did
on
it before.
But what he'll do is he'll at least tell you if it's possible. You're like, if I'm planning on doing this myself, is this possible? And he'll
he's
be really
very good
friendly
at logging every gun build he does
and all the steps,
everything he did. So
yep, all the steps.
He's very transparent.
And then Funny
good.
Ted Gaming, what do you use to make your cream filled bananas? We don't make cream filled bananas because
no,
that's time consuming and I just know where to get cream-filled bananas, www.ampedairsoft.com,
yep.
Where they already have cream in them, www.ampedairsoft.com, where they I can just buy them straight cream-filled, www.ampedairsoft.com.
We love the ATF.
Yeah, so is it my turn or your turn?
I'll pull one.
Yeah, you pull one. I don't remember.
About 20.
I don't remember. So, there you go.
The only thing you can add, which you can't really find anymore, was Lalax kits, but
Yeah, those are hard to find.
Yep.
Speaking of meow, oh man, I'm so bitter about that. I was being way too friendly. If I would have looked first.
Yep. This looks like Soul Set. Okay. Bought my SMP for my Frankenstein 416. I'm having consistency issues. I think it's the bucking lips and the tightness, and it's not holding the BB in place. Since the SMP is open bolt, I feel like these problems are common. I've tried a stock brass Promi 603, Pro-In, Flat Hop, Promi Purple, G&G Green. The Promi Purple was definitely too loose. G&G was tighter. The Modify Flat Hop bucking was the best that I've had. I've heard the Madbull Red Shark buckings are good to go to. So I ordered one, but haven't gotten it yet. Thoughts? Short story by the Foxy Softers.
We just got those in. I'm personally running one in my personal gun right now for testing.
Yeah, we're doing some testing on it.
I haven't noticed too much of a consistency difference between like a stock Crytek bucking, a purple bucking, a G&G green bucking, in the jack. Because I'm using it in the jack, which is also functioning exactly like the S&P. It's a nozzle back open bolt system.
Did we put one in the S&P yet?
Not in our shop S&P, okay. No. I have one that's pre-flatted, so okay. I can build it into a flat hop.
Might as well.
So I bought them personally, so they're my personal stuff. So I'll probably put them in like the G3, but like, you know, like it, those tend to hold the BBs a lot better because they actually have little rubber pieces in them that actually grip the BB and hold it in place.
The lips are just
stiffer. And they're stiffer.
Yeah.
And they're also hard to get out too. So once it's in there, you're just like, it's like adamantium. Like you're going to rip the bucking trying to pull it back out. That's how stiff they are. The Promi flat hops probably would work well too if you're looking for something that's stiff to hold the BBs in.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Modify flats I've heard really well. I didn't notice any it shooting any better.
I think I think what a lot of people notice with the sharks is a little bit better with like feeding and BB like seating properly before it even
yeah,
because
I haven't
really
seen any kind of performance upgrade in it at all. But
the guys at Wolverine kind of swear by
them. The guys
so
at Wolverine
we're
swear by them, so we tested
it.
Them out. And to be honest with you, like, I personally, my
that's your turn.
Yeah, my turn. My gun hasn't shot any better with it than all the other buckings, but I could see that it would probably fix that type of problem.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we haven't run into that problem too recently.
No, not in a while.
I'm aware of.
Usually it happens in guns that are, like, old or beat up or like out of spec or just guns that are just like whooped on, like they're just whooped on and things are all loose and rattly then.
Mm-hmm.
That typically happens a lot actually.
There you go.
Ooh, got a little novel here. Scott Rowan, hey Amped, love all your mojo. An indoor field I play at in Hudson Valley Airsoft, do not chrono in jewels and allow the same FPS for 2s and 2.5s. A lot of people seem to be shooting hot, and BBs pierce people's skin a lot. The field says it doesn't make sense to switch to jewels and clearly doesn't understand jewel creep. I'm a physics major, so this pisses me off that a field dealing with safety doesn't understand basic concepts of kinetic energy. However, they say that their insurance does not allow them to chrono in jewels. What do you think of this? And is there any way I could persuade them to chrono in jewels? I've already asked multiple times. Well, if they're saying that their insurance doesn't allow them, they're lying to you. They just don't want to.
Their insurance, they may have an outdated insurance that
hasn't been updated
to even understand or know what jewels are.
Basically,
I bet you they're running a whole paintball.
Doesn't matter. What it is that the insurance company just says you're not allowed to. Your insurance covers people chronoing at this. So what they have to do is say, oh, well, if we chrono at this, we can figure that all these guns now with chronoing at this jewel level. The only reason they're not chronoing in jewels is just because they don't want to learn how to do it.
Yeah.
Or they don't understand the importance of it.
Mm-hmm.
It's literally that simple. Bring them a bag of BB Wars BBs and show them the difference.
Yep.
Like, because it's got the jewel chart on it. You can even pull it. Someone's probably taking a picture of it. You can just pull the jewel chart from our bag. Show them the math and show them that it's actually different.
Worst comes to worst, you know, you're going to have to get some of the staff guys there and get some guns that are
chronoing
shooting
hot
at certain amounts
and
that
shoot
would
them
fit
with
under
it.
Their that would fit their FPS rules
and then shoot them with it.
Take a gun that's shooting, you know, 350. Put a 4 in it and see how they feel, and they, you know, shoot them in the chest, you know, see how they feel. Like, ow.
So, is there any way you could persuade them to chrono in jewels?
Well, he's a physics major, so I hope he could explain it the best to him.
You could definitely do a really good job. I think the whole thing is that people who run a business, they want things to be profitable. So, like, there's a reason why some businesses who run indoor places, they run at 400 FPS with a 2. And that has to do with, like, their pro shop, for example. Like, maybe they sell guns, and the guns that
maybe
they
sell
there, most guns usually chrono in at, like, 400 for the American market, because Americans always think bigger is better.
Yep.
Power is better, you know.
Power.
So, like, they just think like that. So it might behoove you to, like, really illustrate the differences and kind of lay it out to them.
Mm-hmm.
And because, like, if they're saying that their insurance policy just doesn't allow their insurance policy doesn't restrict them being safer. Because that would be in the interest of the insurance policy to not pay out money. So if anything, they'd be like, oh, yeah, you found a better way to do it? Yeah, go for it. Like, they just don't want to do it. That's what it is. They just don't want to do it. Or they don't understand the difference, and you just have to explain it to them.
Yeah, because if they're having...
Keep trying. You're fighting the good fight. Keep trying.
Message our Facebook if you need help or anything with that. Because if they're having rounds piercing skin, there's...
A fundamental misunderstanding.
There's some bad apples. There's some people using way heavy ammo. They're tinkering with their guns after they chrono. Maybe chrono's not very strict. Like,
but
how,
either way,
like, how
basically,
do they mark guns?
Even if none of that's true, maybe it's just a fundamental misunderstanding of how it works. Yeah. You're fighting the good fight. Keep going. You're doing good. I have faith in you.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for Rizzle.
And I know we talk about all the time, the Jewel video is coming.
The problem is that I keep going on vacation.
Trying to make you sound good.
I keep leaving for, like, a couple weeks at a time, and then I'm like, oh, yeah, crap, I got to do that.
Mm-hmm. This one's from Ohio Airsoft. Hey, Amp, this is a product question. So I run a mini 7.4 LiPo on my Polar Star. When I plug the thing into the LiPo charger at standard 10G, it flashes red. Now, I've made sure the battery was on LiPo and plugged it in and kept trying. It's nothing. It still flashes the red light.
It's dead.
Amp, please help. I don't know if the LiPo or the charger, because it still works in my FCU, because before my other LiPo, when it died, it did some spooky shit on my FCU. So I don't want to get dead, so yeah, thank you. If the battery may be junk, but it probably still has just enough charge to run your FCU, but
the FCU,
it's not going to accept
the thing,
charge
FCUs
anymore.
FCUs and stuff like that, in all of these systems, they draw small amount of juice.
So it's probably still has a charge, but when you go to charge it, it's probably not. It's something.
Not, probably not
something fucked up with because
LiPos
chemicals.
Have to charge balanced. So basically, like, if you look at it, a 7.4 has two cells.
Mm-hmm.
So let's use an analogy, for example. The way that it's chemically balanced so that it charges up all the way, the cells have to be filled up equally. So, like, if you had, like, two pipes coming out of the bottom of 255-gallon drums, and that was your wire, that's the metaphor for your wire, where they link together. In order for it to charge, the water has to fill them equally so that the pressure coming out of the bottom is the same.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, one side would drain too fast and the other side would drain afterwards. They have to be the same.
Yeah, then
it's the same thing with a LiPo.
And
when they charge unbalanced or anything like that, they're ruined.
So check our, like, probably the most recent one to check is, like, check our Jack FCU video. Make sure your LiPo balance is on.
Yep.
Other than that, you know, like those mini light bows.
Try a different charger if any of your bros or you're ever near the shop or anything like that or near someone who has one of those chargers. Try a different charger. Maybe your light bow's not dead. Maybe it is your charger.
Yeah, you never know.
They're not too
complex.
Eliminate
as many variables as you can.
Eliminate variables so you figure it out.
Generally, though, it's
the battery.
Safe bet it's the battery because that's the thing that's doing the most transfer of energy.
Oh, book.
Uh-oh.
Brady Nowowski. Wow, dude, that... I'm sorry, man. I probably just...
Nowowski.
I'm sorry. Hey, Amp. Just wanted to thank you all for being awesome. I recently bought a Tippmann M4, thanks to you, and the deciding factor being your reviews on it. Well, I'm glad that we do good work. Thank you.
Part 3 coming soon.
Hopefully. I've never had a gun that has been more exhilarating to use, and I can't find anything on the market that's more reliable. Recently, I was brainstorming, and I was thinking that it'd be awesome to take a metal 416 upper and a 416 rail and throw the Tippmann's upper internals in it. Could this, obviously some dremeling and machining, etc. would be required, but do you think this would be achievable? I'm fairly familiar with the upper's format since I've worked on making the hop-up as consistent as possible with multiple mods I've made to it. So I just wanted to see if you all thought it would be possible to make a 416 style Tippmann. I don't think it would be impossible. I just think that,
so much fabrication.
Given my personal level of skill,
mm-hmm.
I wouldn't be able to do it.
I think a lot of things people don't realize is that the Tippmann is actually more, the receiver especially, is more to spec to a real AR, which actually means it is thinner. Because a standard V2 AEG M4 body is wider to accommodate the gearbox, everything smashed in there sideways.
Mm-hmm.
So you definitely have to do a lot of fitment and Dremel and fabrication to actually get the guts into a 416 upper.
Basically, you know what your best bet would be to do? Would be to go in, either you could ask the Tippmann guys to help you do it, or you could do it yourself, or you could take it to someone who knows how to do it, but to 3D model the actual upper, and then take it to a 3D printer, and then mount all of the parts in it, and then change the dimensions that you need to make it fit. That would probably be your best bet if you're good with computers, would be to 3D model it, and then...
I also wonder how strong the backwards 3D printed would be with the Tippmann internals.
Well, no, that's not your final product.
Oh, okay.
You're not letting me finish. Ugh. So, basically what you do is you prototype it, you mount all the parts in it, make sure it functions, fire it a little bit. It's not going to be a long-term solution, but it might work. Then what you do from there is you take that upper, and then you have it machined somewhere. But all of that is going to cost you a lot of money. And in the long run, is it worth it? If you really want it, it could be, but I don't know if it is or not.
Just to put a heavy-ass 416 rail on?
You might be able to modify a Wii 416 gas blowback upper to fit, because that's a little bit closer to that spec of the Tippmann.
Yeah.
That might fit. Just a thought.
Lachinsky again. Finally hit the dark side. We bought a V3 Polar Star. Came with red nozzle. To meet the FPS at a field nearby, I have to set my PSI sub-50. From what I saw, this might be bad for the solenoid. Thoughts? Also, Matt, hope you make it to the lead barbecue. See you all, Blind Fury. I feel awful I couldn't make it to that. I should be at Blind Fury. You'll be on vacation
already. I'll be on vacation.
And then you're the solenoid expert.
Okay, so basically, Polar Star solenoids do not like to run sub-80 PSI, usually.
Did he say what Jenny had?
Probably. He has a V3, so okay. It's the same stuff as the Gen 3 V2. They don't like to run sub-80 PSI, and basically it has nothing to do with them breaking or falling apart or anything like that. Basically what it is that there's not enough pressure running through them to make them function correctly, so that when they function, they have air leaks and stuff.
Yeah, the nozzles and valves and shit are getting stuck, half open. There's not enough pressure behind them.
Like, for example, when I had the Dank 16, when I took it to the C7, Op-X, I had a 20-inch PDI 605 in it, which means that in order for it to chrono legal, because it had a tight bore and a red nozzle in it.
It was like a 601, wasn't it? Or
600? No, it was a 605.
Was it?
Yeah,
I thought that PDI was stupid.
No, they only make 605s and 608s. Okay. That's all they make. In order for it to chrono, I had to run the PSI at 50. It made these weird farty noises, and so if you didn't shoot it for a while, the first two shots would just be dead shots because it wouldn't have enough air cycling through the system to make everything function. So it would be blurp, 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 crank, 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 and you'd be like, oh, we're good. And then, like, if I unhooked the air and then hooked it back up, it would be like, blurp, 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 yep. Clank, 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 and it would just be, like, running again.
Ridiculous.
It was stupid, but it worked really well, actually. It shot really well. It just leaks and is not efficient. Older gen solenoids actually run at lower PSIs. If you can find old gen solenoids, like, from gen 1s, those run at 0 to 120.
Good luck.
Good luck, but those are way quieter, and they're way better at running at low PSI. If you can find them, or if anyone has a Gen 1 Fusion engine, they can attest to it. It works really well, actually. Joe Man, first, how do you guys transport your gear to events? I've seen people use storage totes, crates, and big-ass bags. Well, I added the ass in there. Also, what do you think is a good price for M4 midcaps? I've seen $13 from a mag. Is that reasonable? And Matt's face when that guy walked like 2 feet away from him for the lulz, #beep. All right, so we use LBT rolling loadout bags. They're expensive. They're expensive. If you can buy them on sale, you can get them for a decent price, but they're generally expensive. I love those.
They're so nice because they just have everything.
Everything in one
spot.
Bag, and it rolls, so you can just walk with it.
Yeah.
Also, a lot of guys use Pelican cases. Some guys use Pelican cases in the shop to do stuff.
Or like even like the big Tupperware totes and stuff like that. Just something that keeps everything, you know, kind of sealed up in one
place. A big backpack.
Mm-hmm.
Big duffel bag. Mid-caps, that's $13 is a decent price for a mid-cap, depending on what quality mid-cap we're talking about. Because a nice X-Mag mag is $15, an EPM is $19, your average Amoeba mag is about somewhere in that gray area, something in there.
Yeah.
Between that $15 and that $19, it falls somewhere in there. So, like, it depends on what you're going for. If you're looking at, like, an Elite Force mag or a mag brand plastic mid-cap, those should be running in, like, your $8 to $10 range per mag, which might be a little steep for those. Just keep that in mind.
I'm assuming it's a play on Jet the Airsofter. Hey, Amp, I was wondering what you guys think about opera derps or who like to blast music during BB Wars. I personally think it's annoying as fuck. # gonna shoot them with my cream-filled banana. # cry about it.
Well,
we're your number one culprits of that.
Well, at Irene last year, we took zero seriousness to the field. And we walked around with speakers, and because we were supposed to be the Somalis, so in all honesty, we were being hilarious for the sake of being hilarious.
To be fair, we were being more accurate.
We were being more.
We played soccer.
We were being more accurate. We played soccer, and we didn't take the game too seriously because, in all honesty,
we had cat shirts.
Especially, we had cat T-shirts. We were Pussy Patrol. the best part about it was that, especially in the first scenario, it wasn't like that in the other scenarios, but in the first scenario, the good guy team, the Rangers and stuff, they were just getting raffle stomped so bad that, like, we, like, were doing things on purpose to not play well so that they could have a chance. So, like, we would do suicide runs straight towards them and get murdered. Out in the open across, like, 100-yard gaps. Like, you know, it was just, like, whatever.
Yep.
And so we were playing music so we couldn't be sneaky and, like, we were just
the 24-hour
24-hour He-Man loop. We were being, so, you know, you probably hated us. I don't know, whatever, I don't really care. Do I mind it? I mean, it doesn't matter to me.
Certain games it can be annoying,
games,
but most
certain
of the time,
games it sucks because, you know, it's about, like, what that game is trying to portray.
Yeah.
If it's a super serious game where people are supposed to be super serious, I could see where it would be annoying.
Yeah.
But, like, at your local open play, I could give two shits what people do. Like,
Love when dudes bring, like, OG boom boxes and they're carrying them on their shoulder.
Roll out like they're from Compton with their giant boom box.
There was a guy at Revelations, I think at Milsim West, there was one of the Russian dudes had a boom box that was pretty funny.
Yeah, he had it in their, like, their CP, I think, and he was just blasting music. Like, I don't care. It doesn't bother me any.
Whatever ruins immersions.
Yeah, it's like, whatever to me. All right, Andrew Raymond, what's up, bros? I was wondering how often one should clean and lube their P-Star Jack and SLP reg system. I play about every weekend and shoot about 2,000 rounds on said weekends. Will you guys do a pleb to pro on Jack maintenance? Keep being awesome. We'll probably roll it into the Honest Guy review, to be honest with you. We'll probably just roll in with that. Here's the thing. When I had my Fusion engine and now I have my two Jacks and my Fusion engine, I only do maintenance on them probably every 50,000 rounds. Thereabouts, and that's
roughly.
Actually pretty conservative. You could probably make it stretch a little longer.
Yeah.
But usually about 50,000 rounds, I like to open them up, clean any of the gunk out of them, take some Q-tips to them, clean out all the old lube, re-lube them, put them back together, clean the solenoids, make sure the mesh that catches all the debris in the solenoids isn't clogged up with, like, stuff. You know, it's about 50,000 rounds.
Yeah. They're pretty resilient. They don't take as much damage and wear and tear as an AEG.
No.
So you're usually pretty good there. Matthew Lerner, pros and cons over Tippmann and Daytona gun. Want to get one of the two, please help. Hashtag Tippy or DG.
Ooh. The Daytona gun is a lot more expensive, but it's a labor of love.
Yeah, you have to spend a lot of time.
It takes a lot of energy to get it to shoot well.
Supplies and BBs to get it broken in.
It takes a lot of energy to get it shooting good. It takes a lot of expensive parts. It takes a lot of custom work to get one working correctly. It takes a lot of love. Mm-hmm. It's not something for someone that just wants to grab something and go play. Like, if you buy a Daytona gun, you're looking at, you know, minimum 5 to 10,000 rounds of it not shooting well.
Yeah.
Of it not shooting it, like, well at all.
Mm-hmm.
And you're like, what is wrong with this thing? And there's nothing wrong with it. It's just all of the mechanical parts in it need to be broken in, and they need to work a lot to get broken in. So, like, your first few games, you're not going to be impressed with it. But then I've seen people who've had Daytona guns for years, and I've seen one bring one out, and, like, a dude was, like, tack driver, like, tink, like, 250, 300 feet, just, like, shooting little groupings like this. And it was just like,
yeah. Now, the realistic function of them is a lot better on them, too. Than the Tippmann.
The Tippmann doesn't have quite as realistic function.
The Tippmann with the heavy bolt feels a lot better, I personally think. And it has a much more pronounced sound to it. I think it really comes down to, do you want a standard M4 or any of the things a Daytona gun can fit into?
Here's how we'll lay it out. We'll just lay it out real quick. Tippmann is standard M4 only, doesn't shoot quite as good in the long run as a Daytona gun, but shoots better in the short term by far.
Yeah, you put a little love to the hop-up, you can get to shoot pretty well.
Doesn't shoot the best, but doesn't shoot as good as a Polar Star or anything like that, but will shoot fine. Recoil is fun, doesn't have as many realistic functions. Daytona gun has a long break-in, is more realistic.
Mm-hmm.
The recoil's great, but isn't very loud.
No, it just,
it's kind of like, and it shoots a lot slower, its refresh rate's a lot slower, it's kind of like thud, 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 thud.
If you put a banana on them, they're actually really quiet.
And then the big thing about a Daytona gun is that you can get more models.
Mm-hmm.
So they've put them in a lot different guns. So like
LCT AKs, almost any Wii Scars, Wii MSK AKs, ACRs. I think a dude did a.
There's
M30 cal.
There's M249s.
Yep.
M60s. There's a lot of different guns.
Mm-hmm.
I think they're getting ready to do a PKM.
Mm-hmm.
That'd be cool. So like you get more options, but in the short term it won't shoot anywhere near as good. In the long term, it'll probably shoot better.
Yeah.
That's the thing. You got to look at it like this. Like, whereas the Tippmann starts off higher and then just kind of plateaus, the Daytona gun, after a long time, will start to get better. So it depends on how much effort you want to put into it. And the Daytona gun's a lot more expensive.
Yeah. You can get a Tippmann. Tippmanns are what, 450?
Tippmanns are 450.
450, just, and then plus a tank and a slide check line.
About $600.
A Daytona gun.
$650.
The kit alone is...
$475 without a gun.
And then you have to get like a GMP walk or something like that, and that's another couple hundred there.
That's another like $400 or $500 right there.
And
so
then
you're looking
then again, you need a
regulator, tank, which you have to use a Firebase or something
like
that.
Yeah, a Firebase and a standard output head.
And so like you're looking at probably another
$150
$300 and something with a tank and the line and the regulator, about another $300 and something.
Yeah.
So like right there, you're looking at like $1,000.
Yeah.
Versus $600.
And you have to remember, you gotta be pretty confident on like teardowns and maintenance. The hop up break in. You're gonna
Tippmann
tear through.
Doesn't
BBs.
Need anywhere near as much maintenance as the Daytona gun does. The Daytona gun needs a lot more maintenance.
Yeah,
a lot more maintenance. Like every game, you have to take it apart, clean it, and then before you play, you have to lube it up, and make sure it's all lubed up, like with real firearm stuff. All right, bro. So this has been Asked Amp episode 36 in South Park. The South Park Park. It was kind of an overcast day, so we didn't want to go too far from the shop in case it rained. So, sorry guys, if you wanted to see like beautiful overlooks, but the benches were nice. I got to sit on something nice for a change. Anyways, if you have questions, go ahead and submit them down below in the doobly doo. If you have super serious, like legit, actual hardcore questions, like that are actually like. Industry like important need to know type things. Remember,
we've
episode
some good ones already.
We've gotten a few already. Remember episode 40. Mark it out as you want it specifically for episode 40, and we'll root through them. We'll see which ones we got that are good, and we'll take the best ones, and we'll be honest.
Yeah,
that's what we do.
We're slating that one for about mid to late October, and we're gonna have a lot of our like we're going to try and have a lot of our buddies and, you know, industry leaders come out for it.
Maybe a couple industry people to come out and talk, like some hardcore industry people.
So
we'll see how that rolls. That might be interesting.
Get your deepest, darkest BB Wars questions in.
Yeah, like I said, super hardcore questions. Like,
it's gonna be a different format too. So I'm hoping this is something you guys will really enjoy.
Yeah, it's gonna be like more of an interview style with a moderator.
Yep.
So just keep that in mind if you have super serious questions. Otherwise, if you guys have anything else, just go ahead and ask it down below in the doobly-doo. Ask it on Facebook. Check us out on all of our social media jives. Important things coming up. We'll be going to Milsim West and Irene. We'll be going to the Milwaukee Project. We'll be going to Blind Fury.
In Ohio.
We'll be going to Faded Giant in November. I believe it's in November.
I think so, yeah.
We'll be going to Faded Giant. So if you guys want to hit us up at any of those things,
we'll
feel free.
We'll be at Freelander in South Carolina in November as well.
We're also going to try to make it to a couple more Ballahat games before the season's up, and we're also going to go to Revelations.
We'll definitely be at Revelations, and we sponsor all their other games. I don't think we're going to make it to No Crew 2, but
we wanted to.
Glacier, whatever that one is called. I should probably learn that. We'll try and be at that one.
But yeah, check us out, bros. If you guys have questions, ask them down below. Episode 36 is out. See you later.